so that we can have law enforcement on the panel to be a part of the split second discussion. And he sent these two gentlemen last notice. So they're not prepared for anything. And the answers that they would give to your questions is going to be based purely on experience and observation. Is that right? Is that right? That's right. And then you are blessed to have the chief of police. Come on. That's right. Like the young folks say, parents, where do you do that? Okay? To have the chief here with us tonight, so we are truly appreciative. And then to have a member of the clergy right here in your community, Pastor Lonnie. He really cares about this community. He's here. Okay? So with that being done, we're going to engage questions and answers. Yvette, T-Baby, how y'all want to do that? Here you go.
We're gonna let y'all ask them questions. We're gonna let them ask y'all questions, but we're gonna let them tell a little bit about the juvenile system, the reason why they don't wanna go in the juvenile system. Maybe y'all ask them questions about how I don't have to go, what do I need to do not to go. You know what I'm saying? The simple, ain't no question dumb right now, y'all. No question is dumb. If y'all get to ask them a question, you ask them. You know, if you in trouble at home right now, you ask them, or go to your counselor after this all over with.
Where you want to start?
We want to start with them. We want them to ask
them. And then I just want to say, take a good look at this panel, because these are your friends, not your enemies. And one of the mission is, we're going to change that mind frame on it's us versus them, because it's really not. It's really not. All right? But you guys got to help us also to understand what you need as kids. And this is why they're here, because we want to build relationships. When you see your chief of Madison, the chief of police, wave, right?
Exactly.
When you see them not having some problems, say, hey, I need some help. Because the idea is they can help you find resources other than locking you up, right? So when you see any police officers, begin to form relationships with especially the people in your community, especially.
Exactly. How many parents we got here tonight? Can your parents raise your hand? If you are agreeing with everything that you have heard and seen thus far, show by round of applause, just parents. Appreciate that, parents. With that being said, T-Baby is going to work the audience questions. She's going to be like Phil Donahue in the audience. Oh, I'm sorry. She's going to be like,
T-Baby.
Yeah, like T-Baby, okay? Yvette going to work it like Oprah Winfrey on that end. And I'm going to work it like James Gordon on this end, Corden on this end, okay? So y'all got it? You ready?
Yes.
It's your turn now. And parents, you may ask the questions also, all right? And we're just going to tell the panel, if you don't have an answer, just always say, I'll look that up and I get back with you. Okay. With that being said, who can start off this discussion? Because we're on a time schedule, we want to keep it going. Who can start off with this discussion about why is it important for you not to go to jail? What's happening in our criminal justice systems? Mayor, do you want, we want to yield to law enforcement? Let's start with law enforcement down there, and then we'll ask the mayor the questions about community. Yvette. There you go.
Okay, what am I doing?
Now, it's his question.
His question?
Yeah.
What's the question you?
I forgot it.
What?
All right.
I didn't inbox that question to
myself. Listen, why do you not want to go to jail? You guys are in probably the most crucial nexus of your life right now. Anything you do is setting you up for your career. You know, good choices, bad choices, and different. Show of hands, how many people, once you guys graduate high school, how many people are planning on going to college or vocational school? Awesome. Well, I'm letting you know now, everything you do affects all that. Whether you spend your time studying, you know, getting good grades, and hopefully get the scholarship, because trust me, I've got little ones, my oldest one's about ready to go into high school now, so she better be studying to get a scholarship, because that's expensive. But everything you do, good choices or bad choices, whether you study enough to get that scholarship and get out and do what you want, or you go out and do some friends are making bad choices, but you make bad choices along with them because you want to be part of the group. That can negatively affect you just as easily as the positive ones. If you make the bad choice and you get in trouble, do you not think that a college looks at that? You know, hey, this person's doing this. Likewise, your grades are going to slip. That sets the tone for the rest of your life. Whether you want to be working in some place earning minimum wage for the rest of your life, or do you want to go out and have a good job, you know, have the white picket fence, have whatever you like, have enough money to go on vacation. You got to work towards that. That doesn't come for free. Everybody up here worked for what we had. I know I came from a poor neighborhood too, living out in the sticks when I grew up. My parents didn't have money to give me. You know, I worked my way through college, had a job the entire time I went through college, all that stuff. None of it comes for free. It's all the work that you put in for it. And like I said, you got to make the good choices now because the bad choices really affect you at this nexus.
Yeah.
Good job. Thank you. So at this time, we want to move on. We are on a time scheduler, so we're going to be pushing it through, okay? At this time, do anybody have a question? Yes, ma'am, can you stand quick? The mic is coming your way.
Respect the mic. Once you get up and talk, we don't need y'all to get to talking. If you have a question, raise your hand.
To just make sure that your question is laid out thoroughly. You know, with all the things that we see today, officers on the media, where it looks like the bad folks are the police, you know, because they see it too on social media. You know, the question, you know, that this young lady wanna know, how do you expect to get that respect in the community when all they see is the negative part? What you do when it comes to engaging young black men, that's what it is. So anyway.
Believe it or not, my mission as a state trooper is to keep you guys out of jail. A lot of people think that that's all we're going to do, take people to jail, write tickets. Typically when we approach you guys, you don't even have to respect us. It's about command and control. We want to go home and things in the lane like you guys do. And I understand you see a lot of the negative stuff in the media. I see it too, and it sickens me. There's some good, some bad, some things are justified, some things are not. And a lot of times in the media, you see a small snippet, a little piece of a story. You never see the whole story. And that's how the media makes their money. So keep that in mind when you get approached by a police officer. If we ask you to keep your hands out of your pocket, the reason we do that is because we don't know what you have in your pocket. If we say, put your hands on the steering wheel, keep your hands on the steering wheel. It's about safety. If we're safe, if we feel safe, then you feel safe.
So when they don't do that, is that part of the split second decision that could cause the situation to go totally negative?
Exactly. Everything that I do everything the same. I treat everybody the same way until you give me a reason to escalate to the next level. Example, traffic stop. I go up to the car, happy, smiley face. Hey, Trooper Lowry, the reason I stopped you is because you were driving too fast today. Where are you going in such a hurry? They usually give you an answer, but I've had some stops recently because of all the media stuff. People instantly, as soon as you walk up to the window, to the car, they're cursing you out. Oh, I'm tired of this BS, keeping it PG-13. I'm going to put this on Facebook Live. And it's kind of frustrating if you can't do your job. And my original reason for stopping you was to tell you, hey, your license plate light is out, or your tail light is out, get it fixed. Because if you don't get it fixed, you're going to get stopped again, again, and again. And if you can spend $2 or $3 to keep the police from bothering you, why not do it?
Very good. Young lady, did he answer your question? Are you bad today? Okay, come on with me. This is your time. Come on.
When people is not keeping their hands in their pocket or on the steering wheel, why
think that's a misconception. Like I said, when you see the news, there's a whole story. The things you see in the news probably last 15 minutes. When you see the news, you see about maybe 45 seconds after things have started to go bad, right? That's what you see. You don't see the beginning when the officer came up, hey, I'm Officer So-and-so, the reason I stopped you. Typically, when it gets to that point, let me back up. So, typically, it doesn't go straight to a weapon. It doesn't even go to a taser. That's what they call escalation of force. Verbal, officer presence, that's what we do. We command you several times to do something. And yeah, you're detained, you can't leave at that time. So, I mean, it's in your best interest to do what we say. Yeah, there's a couple of other options we have, but for the most part, we want everything to be friendly. We don't want to hurt you, we don't want you to hurt us. And we don't know you, you don't know us, right? And ask your question, I need to go further.
Yeah, because what you said, like, they're police officers are not mind readers, okay? They don't know what you're thinking or whether you might want to do something crazy because something happened to your uncle or your brother or your father or something, you know, what you seen on TV last week. So they are in such a situation that could go bad for them as well as you. Is that right? Officer? Okay, yes.
When you start with the disciplinary act, that's like when you start with the disciplinary action. First, the dean of students will give you a verbal, or no, first your teacher will say, don't do this, don't do that. And then next, they'll write something on a piece of paper. Then you'll go and talk to the dean of students, and then it'll escalate. It's the same thing. It starts off with just a miscommunication, something happens, and then there's that verbal talk, just like in school. And that's why they're here, to try to prevent you from getting to that point.
So what are they doing that gives them that weapon? What can they do or not do?
Well, they can, as the officer said, the same thing in school they could do, like if they're with the police, be respectful all the time. Like Ms. Yvette said earlier, all the time the teachers don't understand that maybe last night somebody got into a fight or somebody tried to crawl in your bed or something like that went on. So they don't know what's happening at your house. This is real, I'm keeping it 100. The things that happen in the house, maybe they don't know that you didn't eat last night because your mother or father or whoever is supposed to be taking care of you wasn't there. So be respectful. We talk about it all the time. Those are things that can keep it from escalating at school or out of school.
Exactly. And that's what Yvette was saying earlier. Thank you, Ms. Johnson. And did you all understand what Ms. Johnson just put out for you?
Yes.
Okay, work with it then. Who has another question? Come on, you got to. Don't let her be the only brave person in the room today.
I have a question. Can a male officer search a female?
You guys said no?
The chief looked like he wanted to answer that. So go ahead, Chief.
I was simply going to say yes, we can.
Is your mic still on?
They're saying no.
You can. As a male officer, I can check a female officer. Now, is it in my best interest to have another female officer check that female? Absolutely. Sometimes we don't always have that option. Therefore, for my safety and the safety of others, I may have to check that female. So it is permissible to do so.
Okay, do you guys understand what he just said? If you understand, show a round of applause. I appreciate it. Today's whole program is about you. You getting it, okay? And so, yes.
Let me add one thing to that. That is just basically like a pat down or a search if you're arrested. I'm not sure if the question wanted to go this far, but as far as a strip search is a totally different animal. That basically, we have to do that with a search warrant issued by a judge, and it has to be a member of the same sex doing so. You have to be in private. There's a bunch of different guidelines that you have to follow to have that met.
Very good. Do you understand?
Yes.
There's two different types of searches, okay? Go ahead, Officer Lauren.
To piggyback on that, when searching females, you know, it's common practice, and this is what they trained us, we don't use the front of our hands, we use the back. So you can't grab anything like that, and that kind of makes you feel a little bit more comfortable than us doing this, right? You don't want us touching on it like that. Another thing we do is we put you in front of our cars, which there's a camera, and it records everything. So if you feel you were violated in any kind of way, you can bring that up the chain take it to our commander, whoever, and make a complaint. And they'll pull the video and see if anything inappropriate was done. But usually, 9 times out of 10, it's not going to happen because I value my job, just like the rest of these gentlemen up here on this panel. So.
Very good. Questions. What questions do you have? Parents? Yes, ma'am.
What does the mayor plan on doing for our community?
In regards to? We want to keep the focus, okay? I respect your question and I honor it. Today's focus is on law enforcement and community.
Okay. When I get pulled over and an officer come up to me disrespectful and talking out the way, am I supposed to just sit there and take that disrespect?
Now, I can take that question because you framed it the right way. Good job. Hold on. Told you I'm old school, right? Okay, Mayor, can you address that question? Did you hear the question? Okay, she wants to know when officers pull someone over in your community and then it gets out of hand. You know, they're very disrespectful and they're not allowing for the communication process to take place as what we're talking about today. They're not allowing for the equal exchange of respect. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly.
Okay, thank you, Mayor.
I get calls every once in a while that relates to what you're saying. We have a process. I would have you one first go to the chief of police and file a formal complaint. Then we've started a record as to how we can look into that. Chief will look into it. And here's what I tell everybody, adults as well as the children or the families that may want to come in. It's a little bit hardcore what I'm about to say, but that's the way I do that, and you can ask your chief. You can come in and make that complaint. If you're not satisfied with the complaint, I direct you to go straight to the FBI and have them do the investigation. You can go, and no disrespect to the state police, but we have found that you can go to state police, you can go to state's attorney on there, but I am very confident of the people that I have on my police department in there, and we will, and I will direct you to Fairview Heights and state police, to the FBI office. They will do a complaint, and Chris, we've done that on several occasions, correct? It's not that I'm going around, my chief starts it out, it's not that I'm going around any of the other agencies, but I feel that confident that we want to look into that, especially if we have someone in our department that maybe needs to be, that may be guilty of what you're saying. But out of the 20 years that I've been mayor, I have yet to have one of those go the other direction. So I would recommend that that's what we would do. If you came to my office or the parents came to my office, I would sit down and see what the chief is about, and then we would send it on up the chain that way to do that. And listen to some of the other questions there. One of the things for the community that I have to do for the community, which would be for the youth as well as the residents of the community, moms and dads and the rest of it, my job is to pick the right people to do the jobs they do. I'm the chief, and the main one is my board of police and fire commissioners. So they look for people who get hired in the police department or fire department on there, that they pick the right people to do the right job. And I think over the years we have done that. We just appointed a new police commissioner Tuesday evening, Donald Turner, on there. Derek Wise, I think the two gentlemen at the end of the table know Derek, on there. And then Dickie George is another one. But these are good police and fire commissioners, and I won't hesitate to have police and fire commissioners step in for anything that we feel has maybe been done wrong or something that they can handle.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, did that help?
Yeah.
Let me hear you.
About
you,
T-Bay. To the mayor and to Miss Lady, I guess she really was talking about a community question for real. What is the mayor going to do with the youth to keep the violence out, the youth to keep them safe on the streets of Madison? You've been in 20 years, so evidently he's doing a great job because he's been in 20 years. But what she really want to say is, that we need the law enforcement and the community to combine to each other, not to confine this just to the school, it's to the whole community of Madison, Illinois. You know, so now they can, the kids that's here, they might go out and spread the word, but we need the community to be involved also. So maybe, Mayor, you can have us back and we do a big community event outside with the law enforcement and the community and the parents to get together to know each other and to know the new elected officials too. So maybe we can get that throughout the summer or something like that, maybe schools or just the community and the parents. Maybe you can help be over the program. Ma'am. Maybe we can get the parent and DJ 1000, maybe we can be the DJ of it, you know? And maybe we can get the parents involved in this also, because it starts at home. We understand that you have to do what you have to do, but sometimes the coaches and the mentors and the counselors at school see the kids more than the parents do, because the parents be out doing what they need to do to hold the household down. So maybe one day we can come and talk with you and we can get this going on with even a basketball, something. It's something that's important to the community also, to get the people involved.
In other words, Mayor, as you prepare to answer that question, I think, in other words, you need to think about spending some money in your community to bring your community together. Because oftentimes, communities are divided, but leadership don't know that. So, but the community, in the trenches with the community, they know it. And I think that's what they're asking for. How can you bring everything together?
Well, my hats off to the school district and this panel that we have here today. This is the first that I've seen, and I spent my time on the school board prior to becoming mayor in there, and I think this is a step in the right direction on there. And I think we can do what you're asking for. Our city is in the same boat that Mrs. Bookins is. The state up there has cut back on funds, so much in unfunded mandates to do that, but we will try and find time and money in the budget to try and get these officers some overtime or something to get involved with either a gathering or some kind of program. I was hoping to see some of the things that we might be able to do there by sitting on this panel this evening.
Thank you, Mayor. Hey, guys. We have a long way to go and a short time to get there. We are like 30 minutes out, so we're going to move very fast, okay?
What we're going to do, what we're going to do, we know it's time, we know it's time, but right now we got to, we got to.
That's the, some of the background for you. We're going to have a very engaging time. It's some parts of it is going to be entertaining, and the other parts of it is going to be news you can use, okay? So we're thankful that the elected officials are out today. We're thankful that the administration is out, the parents is out, and you, the students. So once again, for your being here means that you are concerned. And we thank you for this opportunity to create some pathways for you. At this time, I would like to introduce the Juvenile Justice Council Task Force. We were given the task. And this time I'd like to bring up Terrell Jenkins, better known as T-Baby. If you know her, go ahead and holler for her, because she puts it in the communities, I'm telling you. So, when it comes to young folks, the House of Ooh Wee does so much in the community for young folks and seniors, or elderly. Okay, and the next, the brainchild behind this presentation today, the lady herself, Yvette Hicks. Let's give her a hand, Yvette Hicks. You're going to hear from them later on in the program, because we all got a part to do. I'm not your MC, I'm just starting the program. In fact, Terrell Jenkins is your MC, but let T-Baby give you a little word or two.
Well, how y'all doing? How y'all doing? We just want to break the ice a little bit. Y'all heard what he said, he was doing. I'm breaking down y'all language, y'all. We here to keep y'all out of jail. We here to keep y'all out of prison. We here to keep y'all in school. We here to let y'all know the do's and don'ts for y'all to stay in school to graduate. We want to know y'all peer pressure. We want to know what's going on. We really want to know, because the trust is down. So we really want to know what's keeping y'all out of school. What's stopping y'all focus on y'all class, y'all homework, y'all everyday activity. Even when y'all, we care. Even when y'all leave out of school, we care what happens to y'all at home, on the streets, on the way back to school. So we really care. So we care. I hope y'all pay close attention what y'all learned today to take it back to y'all friends. To let y'all know what y'all can and cannot do to stay in school, to stay out of jail. You're too young, so we trying to approach y'all and get y'all right now. So when you get to out of school, senior high school, you'll know the fundamentals to stay in school. So y'all get that academic that y'all need. So the kids won't talk about y'all. Y'all won't talk about each other. Let y'all know how important it is not to talk about your fellow students, your fellow friends. You never know what they're going through. They might be going through somebody raping them at home. They might be bullied because they don't want to walk to school. They might be bullied because their hygiene is not right. So you never know what's going on. So we're here to catch y'all at an early age to show y'all it's a better way out. Okay? Okay? All right, now we need y'all sit up in these chairs. Sit up in the chair. Y'all put everything else on Facebook. When y'all record, put this on Facebook too. Because it's going to matter. And while we need y'all, this camera right here, this will be live TV. This live TV. So y'all, you want to put it on you? Y'all get right. Okay? So this is what it do. Y'all pay close attention because your parents, your peers, your teachers, the principal, the mayor, is he here too? So we definitely need to be on the good behavior, okay? And I need y'all to speak back to me. Okay? That's what I'm talking about. Let's go. This is my daughter too, y'all. Let me introduce you, my neighbor. This is my daughter, y'all. My daughter, 31 years old, going on 32. I don't want to look that old. But this is my daughter, my only biological daughter. Speak to her. You know, don't act like this now, y'all. Y'all ain't in time out. Y'all ain't in time out. You want to hear some rowdy, some everything up in here, okay? You know, we want to give the DJ 1000 in the building. What's up, DJ 1000? He right here in y'all community. You know, so let's start this thing off, right? Okay? Let's go.
Come on, y'all. Let's get another round of applause for T-Baby. One thing T-Baby's gonna do, she's gonna keep it real.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. I'm also the station manager of our public access television station, Charter Cable, WESL TV 984. So where I goes, the camera goes, and the tech director for the station, Mr. Lawrence Duncan. Give him a round of applause, because he's gonna be working today. That's where we're going to be moving. But at this time, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, help me welcome to the stage your very own Madison County Superintendent to break the welcome, Dr. Rock. I got a mic right. Dr. Warletta Johnson Brookings. Let's give it up for Dr. Brookings.
Good evening. My task here is to welcome you. But I think you all know, I said, where my song? You know, we start off with what about the children, because everything we do is about the children. So at this time, I just want to remind you that as we saturate the atmosphere, and that as we move forward to Blue Ribbon, that what we do is all about children. We put our children first, and put everything else behind us. We want to present an image that is one of excellence. One of Blue Ribbon status. You see, we will be a Blue Ribbon school district by 2021. And as I look out there at the students before me, I see children who are from a Blue Ribbon school district. So I thank you, and it's important to us. When we came in, we promised that we would provide opportunities for you to get here, for our students to be the best that they can be. So I congratulate you on continuing to work hard and trying to be the best that you can be, because you see, we are a Blue Ribbon School District under construction. We continue to move forward, and we are excited about it. Welcome. Have a wonderful time. We are diverting you from poor behavior, from bullying, from things that reflect negatively on you, because we know you are the best. And we're going to continue to provide opportunities for you to be the best. So I welcome you tonight to this event. Come in with an open mind, an open heart, and leave with what you're supposed to leave with. I'm going to welcome the principal, Mr. Juan Gardner to the stage at this time so we can continue on and move on with the program. Thank you.
Let's give Dr. Perkins another round of applause. Thank you so much, Dr. Perkins. Great visionary, all about Blue Ribbon School District. We're headed that way by the year 2021. We'd also like to thank our staff and our students who are here tonight. It's all about you and celebrating your efforts on tonight. But my role tonight is to introduce three very fine individuals who are here working as a result of two major grants that we've secured here at Madison Junior Senior High School. It's a 21st Century Grant. It is a grant which allows us to have the program you call Project Excel, and also Conversations Towards a Brighter Future. That's also a grant that allows us to do movie night. Sometimes you guys get wonderful t-shirts and such. That's a grant as well. So we have terrific individuals involved with that. And first, there are three people I'm going to introduce right now. They'll come up in this order. First is Mrs. Katrine White. She's a counselor, and she's also over the Conversation Towards a Brighter Future grant. The second person will be Mr. David Jackson, site coordinator for the Excel program, along with our project director, Ms. Johnson, Teresa Johnson. She's over the Excel program. She's also the district-wide nurse. And Mr. Jackson is also the dean of students here at Madison Junior Senior High. And Ms. White, of course, is our school counselor. At this time, let's welcome Ms. White.
So Brighter Future is a program that we have that allows us to have fun things like Mr. Gardner said, movie night. We gave away free donuts when we set up a yellow t-shirt. Joe, get it. So this fun t-shirt, turn around so everybody can see it. To love me is to accept me. We have those t-shirts because of Brighter Future. We have those t-shirts because junior high school felt that a lot of kids were coming into the school and not being accepted for who they were. They were not getting a chance to understand one another. So we have Brighter Future here who is supposed to make Madison a better place, okay? So that was junior high's purpose. High school's purpose was because they felt that they were not being understood for the person that they were. So, all my Brighter Future kids, please stand up. Jordan. So, they are the ones who came up with the great plans to have movie night, to give away free donuts, to have a family wedding, when we gave away the free gifts on Valentine's Day, and for junior high, when we have field day on Tuesday. So that's because Brighter Future wanted us to have a better place. Okay? So I welcome you guys here tonight, and wake up, have some fun, and let's get this going. Mr. Jackson.
Good evening, everybody. It's my task to spread a little bit of knowledge about what goes on in our Excel program. All of our Excel students, please stand. Give yourselves a round of applause, Excel students. All right, you may be seated. For those of y'all who are not familiar with our 21st Century Excel program, it is a grant that we, our primary purpose is to give our kids a safe environment, something to do after school, to keep our kids off the streets, to keep them safe and sound. Also, to give them some academic assistance if needed. Every day we have at least one hour of academics per day. We follow that up with enrichment. Enrichment is basically
understood.
Teaching our kids skills such as sewing, such as horticulture, sometimes through African dancing, through drumming. We have a lot of different activities going on with that. This year we've been blessed with an opportunity to have a culinary program through Kendall College. There are several students that are involved with that. Be currently involved in the culinary program. Will you please stand? Can you be seated? These students have the opportunity every evening to go down to Bernard Long Elementary We do some webcasting with a young lady named Shoma, who's works for Kendall College, who's working with our students, learning culinary skills, but also learning about different cultures. These students will also have the opportunity to go to Chicago this summer on a trip, a well-earned trip, because they've been doing an outstanding job, being diligent with their attendance and with their participation in the program. Something else we do in Excel, we also attend various field trips. We had the opportunity this year to visit Warrenburg Theater, where we watched Hidden Figures, and about 3 weeks ago, we had the opportunity to go to the Black Rep to watch a film called Seven Guitars. Thank you. I had a little mental block there for a second. Seven Guitars, which is an outstanding play, a live play. So if you're a parent in the district that currently don't have students in the Excel program, please consider enrolling them next year. Well, we will have a summer program this year. We'll have a lot of fun, outstanding things going on. So students also, there will be a permission slip coming soon, so we get you involved in that. One last thing I'd like to do, the Excel staff members that are present today, can you please stand? I'd like to give these individuals a big round of applause, because every day, many of these individuals are also district employees. We know sometimes after a 6.5-7 hour day, it can be very draining, but they also are willing to go the extra mile and stay with us until 6 o'clock in the evening for the program. So we've had a great year with Excel. The year's not over yet. It's continuing to make it great. Students continue with their attendance. You're much appreciated. The staff, I appreciate you for this well. So next, we'll have Nurse Teresa Johnson.
Okay, so this year, Jackson, some of the reactive, unthinking behavior of youth.
But I would just like to thank everybody for coming out. It's really important, it's near and dear to my heart, that young people are connected to law enforcement, that the first time that you have an encounter with the police or with the mayor is not when you get in trouble or your friend get in trouble. That you understand it no matter what's going on all over the world, in our community, Ferguson, here, all the stuff that's going on, that the police officers are still our friends, and that you know how to act in school. And when trauma happens in your life, somebody gets shot, somebody gets killed, there's domestic violence. If you don't know, who know what domestic violence is? What's domestic violence? Help her out. Anybody? Help her out. What's domestic violence? Somebody is arguing and fighting. So the police get called to your house because your mama and her boyfriend or your daddy and your mama are fighting. I don't want that to be the first time that you have a conversation with the police. I want you to feel comfortable. Me and Miss Yvette that have been coming here, Mr. Harrell was talking about the Juvenile Justice Center. For the last 7 or 8 years, we sat on St. Clair County's Juvenile Justice Center. And so we counseled. So we want to make sure that you are getting ready to get out of school and that you know that the police are your friends and how to act and how to behave when trauma happens. It's very important to us that you know how to act. When they pull you over, if you're just walking down the street, whatever happens, we want to make sure that you excel so that you can have a bright future. And all my young ladies and men, y'all look so good. Give yourself a hand. Thank you.
Come on, guys, let's give it up for Ms. Johnson now. Everybody gets a call tonight, okay? Let me also put out there that, you know, growing up, when I was a young guy growing up, because you know I'm old school, I got felines on, okay? So you know I'm old school. I got some horses, though, but I got felines on today. But when I was growing up back in East St. Louis and the Lansdowne area and whatnot, policemen were our friends. Let me say it again. Law enforcement were our friend. All right. You know, we didn't have to go through some of the things that you're going through today because they were our friends and we trusted them to be our friends. And we don't know where the relationship broke down in. But we see a lot of things on social media about the police and law enforcement. You don't like them until you need them, right? You know, because if you're in a situation and you need some help, who are you going to call? Ghostbusters? Who are you going to call? Come on now, you're going to call the police. If you don't know no other telephone number, you know what? Talk to us.
And that's all we're trying to do, to get you to understand that 911 can be your friend. And anytime you have an encounter with law enforcement, there are some other things that has been going on with you from childhood to adulthood that we want to talk to you about today. And that those are the things we want to give you an understanding. When you know better, you do better, right? All right, this is interactive. Let me say that again. When you know better, you what?
Do better.
And that's what we want you to know. Young folks, remember this, that in order for you to make an informed decision or an informed choice, you have to have all of the right information, right? And that's what we're trying to put forth today. So at this time, so me, T-Baby, Ms. Johnson, and everybody else that you see before you that's going to be a part of the panel and all of that, we're just trying to bring it to you like that. And T-Baby is our keep it real person, okay? Some things I can't say, don't know how to say, T-Baby gonna say them, all right? So, with that being said, let's bring up the lovely Miss Yvette Hicks. Come on, give her a round of applause.
But girls, y'all do look wonderful, and gentlemen, y'all do too. So my role is, I don't know if you guys know, I'm a school social worker. I've been a school social worker for over 20 years. I actually worked in Madison my first years out, but I did parent education. But anyway, so over 20 years working with students, I've learned a lot of things. And like Ms. Teresa said, we sit on the St. Clair County Board for Juvenile Justice, making sure juveniles are served right, because we see so many times juvenile are not treated in a certain manner. And we know that there's a disproportionate of minority contact, which means there are more black boys in jail. So something's wrong with that. So we looked at it and we thought about, why is that, right? So we want to bring knowledge to you guys so you're not there. It, you know, you're not part of that statistic. So what I've learned is that I think that how can you relate to an officer, or how can an officer relate to a youth if they don't understand each other? So today I want to bring a little understanding about anger and my professionalism working with kids. I find that when kids are really angry, they act out. Kids have a lot of trauma, a lot of ACEs, which is adverse childhood experiences. That means basically they live in the house probably with domestic violence. Their parents have probably been incarcerated. Anything that affects you. So I always say, I didn't find out how many ACEs they had. Early childhood incidents. How many incidents of trauma have they had? And so when I see kids acting out, I automatically know. We don't need to discipline them. We need to help them.
Right.
So I wanted to, my part is, educate everyone here on what trauma is. And why it's important to recognize that as professionals, as well as you youth, so you can deal with it appropriately, and you're not taking the anger out when something happened, and you're approached by law enforcement, or approached by your principals, and you act a certain way. I see it every day. And guess what happens? You guys are gonna get suspended, you're gonna get expelled, or you're gonna go to jail and visit an encounter with a police officer. There are certain things you guys don't know that you can't do, but that anger is there, and you act out. And 40% of you who are in jail, juvenile, or in jail for things like pulling away from the police or not getting off your phone. The police said, I need to talk to you. You don't have the right to chuck search me. Yes, they do. If they have a suspicion, they can stop you. Their suspicion could be something on your Facebook page. So they see you down in the community, hey, come here. No, you can't touch her. Why are you touching her? This whole big old finagle. Now you guys are in jail for nothing. So we got to make sure that there's some juvenile justice. You understand what you can and cannot do. And we have some officers and state police here that are going to share with you what they want you to know. And then we're also going to have you guys tell them what you need them to know. Because some of my students say, well, Ms. Hicks, they approach us. They make us feel like we're already guilty.
Address the body briefly, please. Just piggybacking on what T-Baby said. We really care about the community. I really care about the youth. Between the wife and I, we have 14 children and 43 grandchildren. So you can see that my need to be able to relate to you is really genuine. I go to 7 state penitentiaries, 1 federal penitentiary. I go to juvenile detention centers and to county jails.
ministered to young people like yourself and to older people like myself. They have a prison in Logan and Decatur that staff all women. And we're in a time now where there's so many women that are in prison. And we are the mindset that we can catch you while you're your age. That you won't have to be one of those statistics that end up going to the prison. And as she said, you know, I'm not talking about anything that I heard somebody else talking about because I made a split decision. Split decisions can work for you and they can work against you. But they put emphasis on the split decision that will cause collateral damage. Anybody know what collateral means? That means it's bad. You know, it's horrible. March the 8th of 1988, I made a bad split decision. And that split decision not only landed a man to be paralyzed from the waist down up until this very day, but it also caused me to go to the penitentiary for 8.5 years. And it was during those 8.5 years that I had an opportunity to reflect back on the things that I said that I wish I had done when I was out. I don't want you all to sit there unengaged or sit there like what we're saying doesn't matter. Every time I go to the juvenile detention center and I see young people, it just really breaks my heart because not only when I see the young people, it's like I'm looking at my own children, I'm looking at my own grandchildren. And just to see you all sitting out there now, it's always bringing flashbacks to me when I minister to my grandson, Lil Lonnie Johnson. He got caught in a situation himself, whereas he made the wrong split decision. One, being in the wrong company. And then it involved a police chase and coming across the bridge, it's happened in December last year, coming across the bridge, they ran into up under a transfer truck. And my grandson was injured, where 1 week later he died from his injuries. You know, so what we're trying to convey to you, it's really serious, you know. It's really serious. You have an opportunity to make the right decision on this side of the wall rather than getting over on the other side in jail or in prison and wishing that you had made the right decision.
That's what we're trying to prevent today.
Decide that you want to do better. Decide that you'll make whatever change is necessary, and sometimes it may even mean making change in friends. If my grandson would have made better choices on friends, he probably would still have been alive today. And I talked to a lot of his friends that came through the juvenile detention center, the Haller House in Evansville, where I go. And there's a lot of them that come through there that were in his circle. And I will try to minister to him just as well as I'm trying to minister to you all. Take a look at your life. Your future is so bright. Look at the representation that you have here tonight that's taking your best interest at heart. Don't want you to go the wrong way. This is really serious. And I really applaud all of the parents that came out to support the children. Praise God. That means a whole lot. It means a whole lot. But if I would say anything, and I'll say this in closing, don't take tonight, don't take it literally, you know, and don't take it lightly, but take it for exactly what it is. It is an event to inform you, to make better choices that you can do. When I saw most of you raise your hand that you wanted to go to college, if you make the right decision at the right time, you'll be able to do just what you say that you want to do.
Exactly. Thank you, Pastor. Hey, by show of hands quickly, how many of you have ever gotten in trouble at home or school or in the community? Raise your hand. Okay. Thank you. You all see that?
Okay.
How many of you have a friend that has gotten in trouble at home, at school, or in the community? How many of you have ever seen somebody get shot? Raise your hand.
Wow.
How many of you have ever seen a dead body? Raise your hand.
Wow.
How many of you are bothered by seeing a dead body right here?
How many
of
you have reached out for help?
How many what?
Have reached out for help.
How many of you have reached out for help and talked to somebody?
What I've seen, especially for a young boy in an African American community where we grew up, we have the stigma that's called, we don't talk to anybody. We can deal with it in our home. You have to get help. Again, how can a person help you if they can't relate to you? But it's up to you to say, I need help. What I find with communities who experience trauma, like the whole community is a war zone. There's no trauma-informed services for those kids. So what they're doing is saying, we're going to retaliate because they're grieving. But they need help to grieve, because you can go kill whoever killed your friend, but it's not going to stop the pain, and it's not going to change the fact. How many of you said you saw a dead body? The one thing with dead bodies, it gets into the senses, and I know police officers can contest this. When you see a dead body, usually you cannot get out of your mind. Maybe the smell, the eyes, or something, and it haunts you. And sometimes we try to say, I don't need to deal with this, I'm going to be okay. Black boys, young boys of color, it's okay to say, I need help, because you need to be the complete you that you need to be.
Exactly.
Okay?
Live to the fullest expression of yourself.
You gotta ask for help. If you experience trauma, how many of you are really angry all the time? For no reason.
Right.
That's what we want to know, y'all. That's what we're here for. That's why we're here. We want to know why y'all so angry.
First of all, they done tripped. They took the discipline out of school. Where you can't get whooped, you know. So it didn't hurt us, it didn't kill us. You know, we got whooped. We got some spots. I don't know about y'all, y'all forget that now, that it didn't kill us. So you kids, y'all angry for real. We just want to know why.
And here's another thing. Police officers, state police, when they approach you and something's going on, don't take it out on them. It's okay to say, I need help. Because the alternative to taking you to jail is them saying, let me figure out what resources. You talk about the mayor, you mentioned the mayor. Talk to the mayor. There are resources. And if he doesn't know, I'm pretty sure you can find somebody to say, we need to give this kid some counseling. Parents, go out and say, my kid is not a bad kid. He just needs help. There's nothing wrong with that at all. All those hands went up. Find someone to talk to.
Exactly. What we're going to do right now, we're going to retire a panel. We know that we didn't get an opportunity to continue this conversation, but we hope to come. Yes, ma'am.
It was beautiful to see this many people here in the auditorium. I see a lot of empty seats. My challenge to each one of the students here and the parents is to bring one more person with you to the next one. Let's fill up this auditorium.
It's your responsibility.
All right, Mayor, you go find that money. And we'll fill up this auditorium, okay? All right. Thank you. Let's give the panel a round of applause for being here and giving up their time today. Mike, you guys tell Commander Ty, I said I appreciate it. Thank you. At this time, we're going to prepare for the final piece of our presentation. This next piece that you're going to see is called Walk the Runway, Project Runway. It's about young ladies feeling confident. It's about young ladies building self-esteem. It's about young ladies saying that, you know, I love who I am because I can put it on display at any time because I like me, okay? As we prepare for them to give their final presentation, there are some young men that's going to give a presentation as well. They're gonna give a presentation to a song called I Rise. And what that song is translating to the young men that's going to be performing on the stage is that black young boys don't have to hold their heads down. They can rise above their circumstances, whatever those circumstances may be. And not only rising above those circumstances, but recognizing that they have risen above those circumstances and doing some productive things in the community. Before I bring them on, I want to share one last piece with you. You all know Dr. Brookings, right? The superintendent. Well, what you don't know is that she and I grew up together, the same neighborhood as little boys and little girls. Not only that, I don't even know how it happened. We went to the same university too. We ended up at the same university. So we've been lifelong friends. Her mom, my mom, we've been lifelong friends. Her mom was the friend to our family when my mom got shot by her boyfriend, blew her head off at a grocery store, then killed himself. So we're talking about traumatic experiences that young folks go through. These things happen in our community, but we have to rise above them. We have to seek the help and the resources to be able to put our lives back together and continue moving forward. Because that's the only way you're going to get to the next phase of your life, right? By moving forward. And I'm telling you, young people, if there's been anything said, done, or seen today that's going to help you get to the next level, raise your hand. Has anything been said? Have you heard anything that's going to help you today? Move forward. Very good. Well, let's give it up. T-Baby, are we ready?